kind of plate bending elements. See, you get with the plates and the in-plane loading. See, normally when you say plate means it's a 2D structure, two-dimensional structure which is called the plate. Depending on the load, we say it is an in-plane loading. When the load lies within the plane of the plate, it is in-plane loading, and the elements we have discussed earlier comes under that category. Then we have again thin plates and thick plates. Usually in in-plane loading we have taken them as only thin plates. So if it is thick, we have to think of thin. Then if the load acts in a transverse direction perpendicular to the plane, if we have a component of the load in a direction perpendicular to the plane of the jumbo, we call it a transverse load or a bending. It induces bending in the plates, so then we call them as plate bending elements. We broadly classify these plates into two categories: thin plates and thick plates. When we say thin, thickness of the plate is small compared to the other dimensions. It takes length and breadth. If the thickness is less than 5% of the breadth, we can easily say it is a thin plate. So it is a relative. Normally thin or thick, it all depends on the overall dimensions. We have the length, breadth and thickness. If the thickness is less than 5% of the breadth, we can conveniently say it is a thin plate. If it is more, then we normally go for thick plates. What is the difference between thin and thick plates? In thin plates, or even in thick plates also, first due to bending, we say the in-plane displacements are negligible. In-plane displacements U and V are negligible, that is the first assumption. Then the displacements are small. Particularly for thin plates, we say the displacements are small. The displacement in the transverse direction is small. And then for thin plates, we also take shear deformation is absent. There is no shear deformation in case of thin plates. And when you go for thick plates, there is a shear deformation. When you have the shear deformation, we have the shear strengths. So in case of thin plates, we will be having only in-plane stresses and in-plane strengths. But the relations are different when it is due to bending action. So let us look at the basic features of this. Depending on the directions you choose, there will be a slight deviation. The directions you have to be a little careful. So this all depends on how we are going to establish your axis. Let us say this is our plate. This is the mid-plane. The one I have shown here with the right curve is the mid-plane. Let us choose the axis. Okay, this is an x-axis. Okay, this is a y-axis. Then this is the y-axis. Always ensure that we will be taking the right-handed coordinates. Then here we have, of course I am not going to everything here, you know. What the kind of stress we get here? This is a mid plane, the so-called neutral plane. And for a loading, if the loading is the vertical direction, downwards, then we have. For a positive load, what kind of stress are going to develop? It's moving like this. Positive load, upward load, in the marginal direction, depending. The top fibers will be stretched and bottom fibers will be. So here we have the positive stress. This is a sigma x is positive here and this will be negative. And similarly, here we have in this direction, on this plane we have sigma yy positive and the bottom it is. Then we have, what about sigma xy, shear stress. So we have the shear stress, this is let's say it like this, sigma yx is going to be what? Why will y here first?
Y
x or x y? How to distinguish y x and x y? Exactly here. If you take this plane, further choose an x y direction. This is, if you have space, you don't overlap them. This is sigma x y. And this is sigma xy, it is on a plane whose normal is x-axis and the direction of the stress component is in the y-direction. First suffix gives the normal to the plane and second suffix gives the stress direction. So here, these are the three stresses we come across for thin plates. If the plate is thick, on this plane we have, what is the stress here? That's the difference between thin and thick plates. Now, there is one major difference when we compute the thinner. When you look at the formulation, there are two ways. One is the differential formulation. We have, what is the differential equation for a plate? If W is the transverse displacement, second derivative of W, dou squared W dou x squared plus dou squared W by dou y squared plus 2 dou squared W by dou x dou y equal to the net upward force. Transverse force. That's the equilibrium equation. You are aware of it? You had a course in plates and shells. You have formulated an equation. But here I will be giving briefly an outline. If you need to formulate the differential equations of equilibrium, we will be getting the moment equilibrium about x-axis. Here we will be having a moment on this plane and this plane. And we will be having the twisting moments here, corresponding to yz, xy and yx, and this will be a moment due to sigma xx, and that will be creating a moment. See, just see the influence of sigma xx, this is very important for us. Just only the sigma xx component I am representing here. This is a wind plane. What is the influence of the sigma xx, tell me? And this direction, this is our x, and here we have this as our y, as we choose the directions. Now, what is the influence of this? This will be creating a moment like this, and this will be creating a moment like this. What is the net moment in a section per unit width? If you take one unit width perpendicular to x direction, you will be getting a moment per unit length of the plane. How do you compute that moment? So that we can say this is the distance you measure. What is this axis? Z axis. If you take this stress here, sigma xx into z is the moment. So sigma xx into z is the moment that we need to integrate from minus t by 2 to plus t by 2. Right? So the net influence of the stress at this section is the moment, and this moment we normally represent, some people represent this my, and sometimes we represent mx. What is the basis for this? If you look at this here, this moment, if you see, is going to rotate a couple, give a couple, the couple axis is y axis. If you choose the couple axis, then we normally represent this as ml. And I put the suffix y, it is the couple due to sigma xx about y axis. In such case, people represent that as ml. Other way of representing, it is the moment because of sigma xx. Moment because of sigma xx, we can say this is mxx. This way we can do this. And similarly, we can get the moment because of sigma yy, that is integral minus t by 2 to plus t by 2 sigma yy z dz. And we have the shear force on this plane. We have the shear here and corresponding complementary shear here. What is the influence of the shear force? Shear stress. That also will give a moment that we call as a twisting moment that we can represent as m xy integral minus t by 2 to t by 2 sigma xy z. Remember here the moment we say plate element, we represent them as 2D elements. And recall the bending of beams, what we did? One integration along the cross section, we have simplified, we converted a volume integral to 1D integral. Area integral we carried out separately, that has given us moment of inertia. Same way, we are going to get thickness wise integration in a simplified process. In the overall expressions for computing strain energy, we will not be having thickness integration. That we complete even beforehand. That we are going to get. Is this clear? Because the stress is varying, so we are going to represent the entire influence of the stress in terms of moments. That's the first. And if we are going to have a thick plate, we also have Qx. What is the influence of this stress, shear stress, if it is present? What is the influence of shear stress? That simply you integrate along the thickness. Integral sigma xz dz, the net shear force. At any given section, if we sum up the influence of all the shear stresses, that will give us a shear force in the section. Similarly, if we take the plane perpendicular to y, integral sigma yz. Given what is the shear force because of transverse shear stress by z. But this will be acting in the z direction. Remember, shear forces always will be acting in the z direction. The suffix indicates the plane on which we are considering this. On a plane perpendicular to x axis, the net shear force is 2x. On the plane perpendicular to y axis, the net shear force is 2. That's how we are. And remember, phase 2 vanish in case of thin plates. Right? Now, let us look at the next way. Here, we call for thin plates, the analogy what we use is called classical plate theory. This is mere extension of Euler-Bernoulli beam theory for 2D elements, of our plates. If we extend the basic Euler-Bernoulli beam theory to a two-dimensional member of a plate, we refer that as classical plate theory or Kirchhoff plate theory. And in this case, let us look at this here. We take one section. Say we have a plate and this is the z direction, x direction, and this is the direction. And the plane, we have taken a section in xz plane. Y is perpendicular to the plane of the plane. Now let us say here the deflection. Now all the deflections due to in-plane loading in the mid-plane is zero, and the deflection of the mid-plane in the transverse direction will be same even. So if we take this as the section here, let us say this has undergone deflection. So if you take a point here, where does it move? This point will be moving here, and this will be also having the same displacement. This also will be having the same displacement. The point here, so this section before deformation will be deforming. As I said, in explanation why in-plane displacements are not there, so the section which is here will go in like this. Remember, for the sake of understanding, I give this as a huge deformation. In general, these displacements are very small. The transverse displacements are small. Then only we can have linear analysis. So the fundamental assumption is transverse displacements are small. In-plane displacements are zero at the mid-plane. Not in-plane displacements here. See here, when it is like this, this is moving in this direction. Half of them are moving in the other direction. Keep that in mind. Then, there is another assumption. Normal to the plane remains normal after deformation. Another assumption of either vernal equation. In total, to bring this here. What is the normal here? Before deformation, these are normal. After deformation, these are normal. Now, we see, this is the transverse displacement of u, obviously, is a function of x and y. The transverse displacement is purely a function of x and y. Now, what is this angle? Tell me. This is the original normal. This is the deformed normal. This is the rotation of the normal. How can you represent this rotation? How can I represent this rotation? The normal is rotating. It is nothing but the slope. Slope relative to x-axis. So it is dou w by x. W is a function of x, y. So we say dou partial derivative of w plus the x. That is the. And in case of thin plate theory, when I say there is no shear deformation, the rotation of the normal and the rotation of the section are one and the same. That's what we mean by saying normal to the plane remains normal even after deformation. So the plane is rotating. Say, let us say, this is the rotation of the plane. And this is the rotation of the normal. If both have the same rotation, normal remains normal. So what is the angle between them? The angle between these two, section and the normal, remains 90 degrees. So when the angle remains 90 degrees, this is the z direction and this x direction. In the x direction, there is no change in angle, there is no shear stress. So, no shear stress. That is the transverse shear is not present here. This is possible only in case of thin plates. Is that clear? I think for the beams I showed you what we mean by rotation of normals. So, this is also dou w by x. Now, when this is w, tell me, what is our u? Let us say, we have a point here. Let us choose a point P. This is the location of point P. And this P has gone to here, P dash. Before deformation, a point P along the thickness, say, at a distance z. Now it has a displacement in the x direction. How do you get that displacement? When there is no shear deformation, so the angle of the section is same as that of the normal. So what is the distance? What is this? This is our u. How can you get this u? This angle is dot w by x. The rotation of this is dot w by x. This rotation is dot w by x. And this is, this distance is z. What is this law? Z sin theta. But for small angles, sin theta is equal to theta. So that is, this is equal to z dot w by x. Look at the direction now. Look at this here. For positive w, what is the positive rotation? This is z-axis and this is our y. Look at this here. We are choosing, see here, it is very, very important. Sometimes we say dot w dot x is the negative sign. Sometimes we say with positive sign. Then even if you look at the way I take the axis, that decides. For example, if I take the horizon here, our y axis is coming like this, x and y, and z always vertical. Our face x, y, z should follow right hand coordinate system. Now look at this here. When you say rotation is there, about which axis the rotation is taking place? About y axis. And when this is rotating like this, is it directed positive y or negative y? Negative y. So this rotation is negative. Dou w by dou x is going to be negative for constant amplitude. That we are, in simple terms, if I take this is dou w by dou x, in what direction is moving? But when z is positive, it is moving in the negative direction. So we can say this is minus z dou w by dou x. Minus z dou w by dou x. That is our displacement in x direction. Same way, let us take this. This is y. Take a section here, and if we take this section now, this will be our y, and this is like this, and this is x. This is. If we take a section perpendicular to this y, perpendicular to this, we have to take, of course, we have to take parallel to this x axis. Same way, when w is upward, what rotate here? Dou w by dou x. Now shall we say v is equal to minus z dou w by dou y minus or plus w positive, what is this putting up for minus z dou w by dou y. So for a transverse displacement of w, the in-plane displacement at the midplane is zero, and there's different displacements at different locations. Is that clear? Once V is there, now what is our strain? What is strain? Strain epsilon xx is equal to rho u by rho x minus z plus by w by x square, and epsilon y by so u by rho by minus z rho square w by rho square, and epsilon x by rho u by rho by plus rho w by rho x, that is minus 2 z rho square w. Energy. If we need to formulate the stiffness matrix, we have to compute the strain energy. How do you get the strain energy? This generate this as some matrix P. into UE. These curvatures can be written as functions of nodal displacements. What are the nodal displacements here? We will see little later. Once I identify the nodal displacement, these curvatures can be represented like this. Is that right? Now, look at this. This is again a simple thing. This epsilon transverse, we write this curvature. Just look at this here. UA transpose B. Given K, some K dash, then epsilon is equal to G times UA. Curvatures in another matrix A dash multiplied by K. Total we can say epsilon is equal to B times UA. Same old notation. Now, sigma, what is sigma? Sigma is equal to B epsilon, right? Then what is here? Sigma is equal to D epsilon, and epsilon is equal to B into, right? And if you bring it here, some B. Right? This we can see. Look at this. I am not going in detail here. DA, DD. That's right. DV. Personal line, this is DV. Integration over the area and integration over the thickness. Now look at this. If you perform the integration over the thickness, the stress when integrated over the thickness, what do we get? When the stress is integrated over the thickness, we will be getting moments. Right? So here, based on this, we can reduce this in a simple way. Integral curvature transpose. Okay, you leave this right. Curvature transpose dk curvature dA. Just you perform only integration on the thickness. Along the thickness, there is no change in W. Remember this. Along the thickness direction, there is no change in W. Whatever the displacement in the transverse plane have at the mid plane, same thing will be there at all the thicknesses. So, whatever the functions we have in this, they are going to be independent of thickness. Is that clear? So, when we are integrating along the thickness, everything will remain same except the sigma axis. When W is same, its derivatives are going to be same. So, only this. We'll be using the thickness integration that will give us one side this. And here, another thing in between, it can be written as dk into k is nothing but m. M is equal to dk times. Look at this here. Yes. Sigma, we can plug these expressions. Sigma can be written as B times epsilon. Epsilon, we can plug these expressions. So here we got only the second derivative of W only here. Second derivative of W, we refer them as curvatures. So the strain energy for a plate can be represented as a product of moment and curvatures. In between, you can write. Curvature, transpose, and moments. Upon thickness integration, we will be getting the moments. So, moment when we write this as dk times k, finally, we will be getting this. As you have seen, curvature can be written as sub b into ue. Here you can say b or the rotation wise, we can say. Curvature itself we call B. Then this will become B dash. But here we will be having this B will not be there. This of this B, what we have used here? Epsilon is equal to A into curvature. Say B bar. we have mixed up the notation in between. Finally, we get, just look at this carefully. When we compute the state energy V of thickness direction, there is no variation for W. So when we compute, when you carry out the thickness integration, we will be getting the moment of inertia terms. Do you remember where the beam what we got? Where the beam what we get? You are not coming across this in plates and gels? Plates and gels. You are not coming across these expressions? I thought you know that. That's why I am making it brief, because you are the first batch in plates and gels. Only thing will be replacing the stresses in terms of the corresponding moments. State energy will be representing in terms of the curvatures and moments. And moment is related to curvature through this decay. It is the function of D for plane stress. That is for the function of D for the plane stress. That if you integrate this, you will be getting this. Okay. Thickness integration will give you by 12 into 1 minus B square something into the thickness. So if you take B as the breadth of the plate, so BTQ by not BTQ BTQ divided by 12 into 1 minus B square per unit area, BTQ by 12 for a beam. B is 1 unit for a unit width. B is 1 unit T as it is, divided by 12. Because of the Poisson's effect in 2D, we will be getting this 1 minus. So this we call plate flexure, and if for any of your books, this passage is available. Any FEA book also will give that. SS Rava Rati book. Our final thing is, this DK is for the plate flexure, and this K is the curvature. What we are representing here is the curvature matrix. This curvature is related to modal displacements. And then we get the stiffness matrix from here, half into V transpose dk and k is dA, right? dA. When you take UE outside, this uses the regular stiffness formulation. Integral V transpose. This D I am using a suffix K. What is the significance of the suffix K? Huh? What is the significance of the suffix K? This will be getting from the D matrix of in-plane stresses, and when integrate along the thickness direction, we are having some area inertia terms. So that's why it's a curvature moment relation matrix. It relates the moments and the curvatures. And the B we have to derive for this. This B we have to derive separately for the plate. Finally, when you formulate the stiffness matrix, formulation of this B matrix is crucial. Now we need to identify W. First thing we have to make an approximation for W. What kind of elements we can think of? What type of elements we can think of? What is the requirement when you make an approximation for W?
Linear
in x and y direction. Then what do we have in the strain energy consists of curvature is the second derivative of W. If W is linear, what is dou square W by dou x square? Dou square W by dou x square is 0. 0 curvatures. zero strain energy. It cannot take any W cannot be linear. At least curvatures must be some constants. Curvatures need to be constant. W minimum need to be whatever. And when you look at the compatibility across element, let us say here. This is our plate, only midsection we are looking at now. We divide that into number of units. If we take maybe triangular, quadrilateral, or rectangle, the choice is anything you want. What kind of continuity you wish to have here? What kind of continuity? W must be same. Across the element boundaries, W must be same. What about dou W by dou X and dou W by dou Y? It also must be same. So curvature, not curvature, slope must be same, or tangent vectors must be same, or first derivative of W must be continuous. So what kind of continuity it is here?
C1.
Minimum C1 continuity. Is it okay for you if you get the slope continuity? What about curvatures? What about the curvatures? Can the curvatures be different for different elements at a common node? At the junction, at the common node, the curvatures also must be same. So continuity of C2 also can be now we have two options. First approximation, let us say constant curvatures, constant. When it is constant, maybe once you take the continuity for the slopes, the constant is going to be same. If you wish to have a higher order, then if the curvature also a linear curvature cannot be constant through for two elements at a junction, curvature is constant, other two elements it is constant, then can we say, can we get the desired shapes? If we feel, then you can look at C1. So we have two different types of elements of plate bending. One element gives C1 continuity, other element gives C2 continuity. If we wish to have C1 continuity, what are our nodal displacements? Nodal displacements for C1 continuity. Recall the beam for beam or nodal displacements. What are you choosing for beam? Beam element, what are the nodal coordinates? W and dou W by dou X also a nodal coordinate. Here? When you go for C1 continuity, then we say W, the primary variable, and two slopes, dou W by dou X, and dou W by dou Y. Elements in C1 continuity, the required nodal coordinates are W and its two first elements. When you go with C2 continuity, what are the required nodal coordinates? And then we have rho square W by rho x, rho square W by dou y, dou square w by dou x. These are the nodal displacements for any right element. We wish to have C2. And here we normally people classify them into categories. Whenever we have chosen all these variables as the nodal coordinates, we establish perfect continuity across the nodes. Across the nodes, we can have them. These elements are called conforming elements, completely conforming elements. The elements which considers W, first derivatives, and second derivatives, all. If all these are nodal coordinates, those elements are called conforming elements. Conforming. Are completely compatible elements. Always are conforming elements. concentrate in the metal. And if you choose only these three, it's even continuity. So there is no guarantee that the slopes are, the curvatures are continuous across the element connections, element boundaries. Then we call them as non-conforming. Are incompatible. Both you define electric. Non-conforming elements are incompatible. And here there was a lot of work that took place in the 80s. Most of the MS and PhD works in the 80s, even early 90s also, to develop the elements for the blueprint. And that too, along with the development of our computing systems. There, people have gone for several elements. There are variety of elements available for this. In that case, I think if you look at R.D. Cook, one of the earliest editions of R.D. Cook, he make a remark. Non-conforming elements are incompatible elements converge fast compared to completely compatible or conforming elements. That's a remark in R.D. Cook's too. That is one of the earliest editions. Surprisingly, in the later editions, that remark is missing. Sometime back when I was discussing this topic, long back, just casually one thought has come to my mind. When you look at the completely conforming element, we have how many degrees of freedom? 6 degrees of freedom. If you take a 4-node quadrilateral element, rectangular element, most of the elements developed here initially are for rectangular elements. Rectangular means integration part we can reduce to regular regions. If it is other than rectangle, we can extend that to quadrilateral by mapping them to natural coordinates. When they are mapped to natural coordinates, for the C1 and C3 elements, the interpolation functions are going to be little tedious. Hermite. You have seen Hermite polynomial? Cubic spline functions. So, cubic splines in both directions. That's how we have to consider them. And getting their Jacobians, that's going to make the matter much complicated. Once you develop the code, there could be, you have to say, when someone has claimed a result in a journal paper, so incompatible elements are converging slow, and incompatible elements are converging fast. That was the conclusion in one of the papers which had appeared in one of the early sections of R.D. Cook's. Then I was suspecting why completely compatible or conforming elements are slow in converging. There could be two reasons. That element is too much for the actual state, for the kind of loading. The complete compatible element may not be required. That means when the slope is linear and the curvatures are constant, when the curvatures are constant, in given problem the curvatures are constant, but I try to approximate them as linear or quadratic functions of x and y. Do we get the converged result fast? Whereas the one element which we see non-conforming, that represents constant state of strain, constant state of curvatures, that's what actually is present in the given problem, so that must be converging fast. See, if one wished to establish this, a possible problem could be choose a problem where the curvatures have linear or quadratic variation and devise an element to represent that kind of approximation for the curvatures and verify whether these elements are going to converge fast or incompatible elements are going to converge fast. Unless we choose an appropriate problem, we can't say generally these elements converge fast. That's what I found some ambiguity in R.D. Cook's book, and surprisingly later edition that particular comment and remarks, that particular paragraph itself is omitted. Just see, classifies them and leaves it. When you are looking at, always one need to verify with the classical problems. in your plates and shells books, you have several standard problems. When you develop an element, you verify first. Is that clear? Now, how to develop an element? Because of ease in computation, I think S.S. Rao gives only a triangular element. And Bhatia, he gives, starts with 400 rectangular elements. I have not come across a book where we get quadrilateral elements for bending. But it is not difficult. You can choose any element, triangular element or quadrilateral element or rectangular element. But lot of work took place for regular rectangular elements and triangular elements. Even if it is a triangular element, what people have considered happen to be rectangular triangular elements. Most of the standard literature, the benchmark problems, what they have considered in the papers also, they come under the class of rectangular or triangular elements with one right angle triangle, where the integration can be performed easily without going into natural coordinates. Without going into natural coordinates, well, that is well. But those who wish to go with natural coordinates, the polynomial functions are available. Hermite. Bilinear Hermite functions. We have seen Hermite in x direction, right? Just your cubic spline blending functions. You take the spline variation both in x and y directions, represent in parametric form. Mid plane, your Cartesian space map to parametric space. Follow the same old procedure you are doing. You can get your stiffness back. But I'll give you a way how to formulate for a rectangular element choosing polynomial of our choice. Okay. So what are the degrees of freedom for a four-noded rectangular element? If you reduce 3, it becomes triangle. Let us go directly to rectangular element. Incompatible or non-conforming rectangular element. So you can take C1 non-conforming or incompatible take this as a rectangular element, perfect rectangle. You can have 4 nodes or 6 nodes or 8 nodes or 9 nodes, the choice is yours. What are the nodal degrees of freedom? W rho W by rho x and rho W by rho. Total size of UE. UE, arc of UE. 4 nodes, each node we have 3. Total is 3 cross properties. 12 degrees of freedom. Element has 12 degrees of freedom. When you make an approximation for W, a function of x and y, how many coefficients we can have in this polynomial? How many coefficients we can have in the polynomial? Huh? How many coefficients? 12, obvious. 12 coefficients we can have. When you're choosing these 12 coefficients, what are the primary requirements to make an approximation for a transverse displacement? Element should be able to represent constant state of stress. And they need to be geometrically isotropic. What do you mean by isotropy? Function must be symmetric. The polynomial function, what we choose, must be symmetric. I say xy now, later I may say x may become y, or y may become x. Just by changing the coordinate system, by reorienting the coordinates in a different way, these functions should not change. replacing x, interchanging x and y, the polynomials will not change. That's what we mean by symmetry. That ensures geometric isotropy. So polynomial must be symmetric. So now when we have pulse, what are the possible forms? Constant must be there. One constant must be there. Constant displacement must be there. When I am taking element, entire element may be moving because of the influence of all the previous elements. So a constant is a must in the approximation. Then we have one term proportional to x, one term proportional to y, linear, three terms. Then when you go for quadratic, x square, xy, y square, six more we have to take. Then when you go to the cubic, x into x square y, x y square, x by 2, we don't have. X square y,
x
y by 2. These are. We need to have two more. We need to have two more terms. We cannot have all the terms of the total. We need to take only the symmetric terms. What are the symmetric terms? Just let us write x4, x cube by x square, x by cube, y to power 4. We have 5 terms, 15. We can't have 15, we can have only 4. Now, what are the possible terms? Two more we have to pick. If we take all cubic terms, we can pick, right? Let me tell you here. By choosing the terms in different patterns, there are different elements possible. If somebody is interested for a mini project, with a single code, by choosing the function, first function, we can develop several elements. And pick a problem, choose an element for that problem. It can be. But the general rule here is follow the Pascal pattern. But we can find another pattern, another variation based on the requirement. The reasons I'll tell you here. One thing here is if you take this, one popular element is this is one choice. We consider the symmetric terms. Okay? And another one here is we can have x square, y square, and x cube by plus xy cube. One gentleman, I don't remember the names of the others. One gentleman chooses x cube by plus xy cube as one term. That can be done. Another fellow takes, he takes these three terms. Here he takes x cube plus y cube as one term. Taking different combinations, retaining the symmetry, we have several possible approximations for the same element. And one of the most widely accepted is this. Check the number 3, 6, 6 plus 4, 10, 10 plus 2. Once you have this, you will be choosing your function. I will give you, those who are interested in developing it for your senior, one of your senior is developing a thick plate for large deformations, non-linear problem. Deformations are not going to be at once, gradually it is going to be different. Configuration also is going to change. That's what Kishan Singh, I think, is not coming these days. Is doing on that. If somebody is interested, we can be in touch with him. Just I'll give a brief outline. Only thing we need to get B. Once you get B matrix, DK is available straight away from the books, or you can derive that. Then only you have to establish B. I'll give you the basic approach how to get. The value of x by now can be written has one xy, x square, xy, y square, x cube, like this. You have the terms of your choice. Then we can have this a1, a2, up to a4. Have a polynomial of your choice. This way normally represent f u of x y is equal to g of x y times f. For this element, what are the nodal coordinates? What are u e? W 1, dou w dou x at 1, dou w dou y at 2, and so on. And last one is dou w by dou y at node 4. For all the considered nodes, choose the displacement and the slopes. This will be our nodal displacement vector. How do you get this? How do you get this? So let's say this is g at x1, y1 multiplied with a. What is a? All the coefficients. Then this is g at x1, y1. If you define this as a function, insert the nodal coordinates of node 1, we get the first one. Then g dash with respect to x at x1, y1, second row. What is the next row? G dash with respect to y, x1, y1, we can get this. So g at node 2, g dash at node 2 and so on. We can have all these things. So this matrix is now purely function of nodal coordinates. The key in the nodal coordinates of this element, we can formulate this matrix. Now let us say here, this is nothing but our, and let us call this matrix as A into. From here we can write A is equal to A inverse, then W of xy is equal to G of xy into A inverse. This is a way of establishing interpretations. Remember, if you wish, if you are in a dilemma, what functions I can choose from the literature for an element other than rectangular element, just replace this xy with coordinates in parametric form. Instead of xy, you bring in rs. You have the interpolation functions in parametric form. Same way, there is no difference. And from here, if you combine this, what terms shall we do for this? This is nothing but our N. Now, what are our curvatures? What are the curvatures?
Second in this again.
So, this is dou square W by dou X square. Dou square W by dou Y square. Dou square W by dou X square. This is nothing but G. G double dash with respect to X. G double dash with respect to Y. G double dash with X. So double dash with XX, YY, XY. So when you say W is second derivative, only this G is function of X. multiplied with A inverse. What can we can do for this? This is nothing but this. If you have MATLAB with you, you feel any difficulty here? Remember, rectangular element happened to be one of the assignments in FE course when I was a student. That time used to be Fortran. Had it been MATLAB, you would have even many more problems. So once you understand this, if there is a D, just the size of WD will be changing and UE will be changing. According to dimensions we modify and we can develop an element with conforming. What is the difference when you go for conforming elements? So we will be adding further degrees of freedom. Accordingly, we will be choosing additional boundaries. As I told, for conforming element, it is 3 plus 3, 6 degrees of freedom. Non-conforming element, 3 degrees of freedom for now. Then people thought, can I do something in between? Curvature may be something I can ignore. Shall I take the twist vector as the degree of freedom? You know what is twist? By the what is twist? What do you mean by twist? Come across your CAD. Now position vector, tangent vector, twist vector. Normally we take only twist. I don't think we use any curvatures there. What has it? In CAD we use curvature in there anywhere. When we develop, when you see the fitting of the spline, we take the position vectors and tangent vectors, at times twist vectors. Particularly for surface fit, we will be going for twist vector. We rarely, to my knowledge, have not seen using the curvature, but here we are using curvature also. Twist is nothing but dou square w by dou x dou y, rate of change of slope with respect to x axis in the y direction. So when you are doing the twist vector, then, what are the nodal degrees of freedom? W, dou w by dou x, and dou square by w by dou x dou y. We have four more coefficients. When you have four more coefficients, so we can take 1, 2, 3. What else we can take? So here, say when you go for another side, x5, x4y, x3y, x2y square, x2y2, x4y, x3y. X by x, x cube y square, x square y cube, x y 4. Now usually if you go into symmetry, here sometimes what people suggest is here, yeah, if I take it this here, can we go like this? How many terms are there here? Up here, 6, this will not be the 6 plus 3, 9. 9 plus 2, 11. How many we have? 4. 4 into 4, 16. So in such case, if you go, it is from here. So always, another philosophy here that is widely accepted is, you go with the Pascal triangle. Just, if we take the maximum number of terms here, if you have third order, or then we have 3 terms in the third order, have 3 terms in the fourth. We have 2 terms in the linear. In the fifth order, we go only for 2 terms. And 1 term in the last. Same thing is what I said here. 1, 2, 3. Then we have 4, 3, 2, 1. 3 plus 6 plus 4, 10.
10 plus 6 is 16.
That's how we can choose 16 terms in a polynomial. This is called Pascal triangle. Widely accepted. So that way you can choose your polynomials. Once you choose your polynomial, getting this is. And we wish to get the corresponding polynomials in parametric space, just go with the representation of geometry with four nodes. We have a regular bilinear representation. Geometry wise, we have bilinear. For a quadrilateral, what kind of representation is required for geometry? Lowest order, bilinear representation enough. But for field variable, we need to have higher order. Then sometimes these functions may not be available directly. Then, in place of x and y, you bring in r and s. Bring in r and s, then you establish the functions. Those are having with a little working experience in MATLAB. Within half an hour, we can develop a code to establish the interpolation functions. In terms of symbolic code, you derive this. Give the total coordinates. Minus 1, minus 1. 1, minus 1. 1, 1. Minus 1, 1. Give them as nodal coordinates. In place of x and y, you give them. Got a point here? You establish them. I'm telling you, you can get several possible interpolation functions in parametric space. Possible that give you new directions in our CAD area also. CAD will be representing the surface of higher order. Higher order surface fits are required. Maybe we can choose the polynomial. What we wish to have. That we can now map onto parametric space. So that is one direction. So this is for thin plates. Now you see the how many possibilities exist for thin plates. Now what about the plates? What about the thin plates? What is the difference we are going to have? Thickness is considerably large compared to the other two dimensions. We have to go for thick plate. Great. If the thickness is uniform, possible, we can go for thick plate analysis. The thickness changes very often. The thickness is not uniform. Then possibly we have to look at 3D So only once you understand this, there's only minor difference. Particularly with the knowledge in plates and tests.
How many of you are familiar with the
finite plates? You have solved the equation for the second order equation for both finite plates? You have come across all the boundary conditions? At least rectangular and circular plates? Let us fix the plate. Before deformation. Thick plate. I'll get a major difference here. Here also, the fundamental assumption is is moving up to here. This is W. This is the normal road W to X. And this is here. There is a difference here. The only difference I am telling you here, when the thickness is small, the rotation of the normal to the plane and the section are not the same. The rotation of the normal and the section are not the same. Then we have epsilon xz that is equal to rho w by rho x minus rho by rho x. I negative, the derivative for positive it is going to be, the direction is negative. We have to be cautious with the directions. So we can see theta y minus root of theta by x. Sign convention one has to be little cautious if you are calculating. Otherwise, if you are using an element, you be cautious about the sign convention in the element. Then, same way, if you take this as y, if you take this as y, rho w by rho by here, and this will be z. Sorry, theta x. Then we have gamma epsilon y z is equal to theta x minus rho. We have just your space. If the plate is thin, theta y is equal to rho w by rho x is 0, and theta x is equal to rho w by rho y, both are 0. In thin plate, this transverse shear will vanish, but in the case of thick plate, the transverse shear is going to vanish. Then we have, for every no, the degrees of freedom. What are the degrees of freedom? W is 1 degree of freedom. Theta x and theta y are 2 degrees of freedom. They are not related to W independently. So, every node has W, theta x, theta y. Then we can go for at least rho W by rho x and rho W by x. If you take this 3 plus 2, 5 is a non-conforming element or imperfect. And remember, we have to make an approximation for W as well as theta x. For this, W, you have to make an approximation for W and we make an approximation for theta x as a function of x and y, theta y also as a function of x. So the approximation now requires not only for W, even for the transverse rotations. Rotation of the section. Rotations also need to be considered. And here, this depends on, this is a function of W I, W 1 to W 4 and rho w by rho w. So how many coefficients here? In w, how many coefficients are there? W and its two derivatives, 3 at each node, total 12 coefficients in the polynomial. Same as the one we have seen for the infinite. W can model the same 12 coefficients. But this theta, theta is a function of theta x at 1, theta x at 2, theta x at 4. With the 4 node head, this will be having only 4 coefficients. Just you can go with bilinear interpolation. Same way, theta, theta y, whatever the interpolation name for theta x, can be used for theta y also. Bilinear interpolation for rotations. Then, same old w, add this. With this, what do we get? What additional things you are going to get? So here, moment side, we will be getting mx, my, mj, m, xy, then we have 2x, qy. Moments we will be getting along with the moment of the shear forces. And what are the shear forces? 2x and 2y? Is q, not theta, q. What is qx? The summation of the transverse shear stress in a plane perpendicular x axis. Qy is summation of the shear stress along the thickness direction on a plane perpendicular to x axis. So, this now related to, these moments are related to curvatures. Now here moments are related to curvatures and also theta x theta. Got a point here? So here the curvatures and theta x theta. So of course here, and let me tell you here, there is no change in the first part. Rho square w by dou x square, rho square w by dou y square, rho square w by dou x y, same as all. And what is shear stress is proportional to? Shear strain. What is shear strain? Shear strain in x direction is equal to theta y minus rho w by dou x, and this is theta x minus rho. Because of the sign convention for theta and rho w by dou x. Once you identify this, earlier for thin plate, you have three moments and three curvatures, but here we have along with the moments with the shear forces and two shear stresses. And here we will be getting D for thick plates. We have D curvature, D thin, now we have D thick plates. This matrix, first 3 by 3 is common, corresponding to the shear terms will be getting some additional terms in the last course. But here when it comes to thick plate, there were several issues. Now look at strain energy. How do you relate strain energy? B transpose D for thick plate into B. What is B? What is B in this case? What is B in this case? Relating this curvatures with the transverse shears. And just look at what is approximate for W. Look at C1 continuous elements. For C1 continuity, we have 3 W and its 2 derivatives, 12 coefficients. For 12 coefficients, what is the order they are getting? Fourth order polynomial is there. For 12 coefficients, we are having 2 terms from fourth order. Or fourth order, third order, only third order, cubic terms are there. We have cubic terms and curvatures. What order we get here? Rho square w by dou x square is equal to linear. W is cubic, so there will be linear terms. What is rho w by dou x? Quadratic. What is the theta y? Bilinear. Right? When you multiply here, this B consists of 5 into 5 rows and number of degrees of freedom depending on the nodes. For 4 nodded, rectangular element, each node has got 3 plus 2, 5, 20. Right? B has 5 in. Is the order same for all the elements? Order of the elements is not same everywhere. Some elements are lower order, some elements are higher order. P transpose B. P transpose B. What is that? P transpose B. When you multiply, we will be getting the elements of the stiffness matrix before integration. Integral P transpose D B is a stiffness. Elements of B are of different orders. P transpose B will be of different order. Now, if you follow the general guidelines of integrating them numerically by choosing certain number of integration points, then there was a danger. Initially, people took long time to understand the phenomena, what is happening. In the shear, corresponding to the shear direction, the stiffness what people are getting is much more than what actually it is supposed to be. Because of the chosen number of integration points by evaluating the stiffness corresponding to the shear terms is much more than actually what it is present. So in the shear direction, let us say here, this element, in the shear direction, the stiffness is more than what it is supposed to be. right? And so this cannot deform. When there is a huge stiffness, can it deform in the shear direction? It cannot deform. If it cannot deform, it is going to be like a rigid. If it is rigid, it can take more than what it can actually take. So it will not deform properly. Because of huge stiffness in the shear direction, the deformation pattern what we get at the end, even in other directions also, not what it is supposed to be. And this phenomenon is called shear locking. Because of using the same kind of integration for all the stiffness terms, the stiffness term corresponding to shear direction are slightly high, not slightly, much higher than what it is supposed to be. Due to that, there is a huge stiffness of shear direction. When the stiffness is more in one direction, the deformation in that direction is low. If it cannot deform in this direction, say actually shear direction, what the shear direction is, this like this, right? So the if this is the normal and this is a cross section, this cannot move deform. So this angle cannot change. So angle will not change the way it is supposed to be. So then the entire mesh, in the sense the displacements when I try to get for W, that will not represent the actual displacements. Lower than it is. This phenomenon is called shear. To understand the reason for this lower displacement, it took a long time for people, maybe almost a decade it took for people to identify this phenomenon. Once I understand the reason for it, then there are several possible ways to overcome this. Can you suggest one method to overcome this? Can you suggest any one method to overcome this problem? Because of erroneous numerical integration, at some places we are getting more stiffness. How to correct it? Now the reason is known. How do we choose the number of integration points? How do we choose the number of integration points? Depending on the order of the polynomial. In general, prior to this, earlier, we were having more or less same order for all the elements. So we were choosing the same number of integration points for all the element combinations, elements of a stiffness matrix. Because here when we identify the degrees of how many? 12 plus 4, 16. Right? 16 into 16, 256 elements we have to integrate in the C1 continuous element. So, if you can identify what is the polynomial order for each of those 256 elements, accordingly you choose the number of integration points for that element, then you can correct the error. This process is called selective integration. This process is referred as selective integration process. And then here, this is the mere extension of thin plate to thick plate. If you look at the thick plate, there are several other additions. If I can represent the strain displacement relations to another on the height, what we have taken strain displacement relations, we have taken cleaning. In reality, if I can represent the higher order, if the strains are represent the higher order functions of the displacement, then we call them as higher order plate theories. Once I have a higher order plate theories, then there is a need to go for more number of degrees of or higher order continuity. Higher order continuity. Can you guess the number of degrees of freedom? If you go for C2 element here, if you go for C2 continuity, W, two first derivatives, two curvatures and one twist vector, 6, and two rotations, 6 plus 2, 8 degrees of freedom for now. Even if you take a 4-noded quadrilateral, 4-noded rectangular, 8 into 4, 32, stiffness matrix size 32 by 32 without engaging a slave. Is it possible for us to do all that? Is our slave? Take the help of a computer. If you know what is to be done, that is your slave. Otherwise, it comes with preloaded package and you have to depend on that package based on its own limitations. At least if you have an ability to dig into the element features, then you can make use of them in an effective manner. I hope now you get some idea how to interpret the elements. Given an element, identify the degrees of freedom, identify the interpretation functions, what is the order of different levels, curvatures and slopes. Is that clear? Now this is about the thin and the thick plates. Okay. Now few minutes, we will be completing the shells. What is a shell? What is a shell? Just remember, bar and beam. When you superimpose bar degrees of freedom and beam degrees of freedom, what do you get? Plane shape. In a similar manner, superimpose axial displacements and transverse. That means in plane loading and bending loading, if you superimpose, we will be getting U and V degrees of freedom for in plane loading, and W and its derivatives along with rotations we get for bending. So bending and inflame together, if you take, that will be shell. When it comes to shell, we have flat shell. Element in general is a shell, flat. Flat means just a flat surface with some thickness. It's a thin or thick. Superimpose UV, just like the way we have superimposed bar and beam. Superimpose in plane display stiffness corresponding to UV and the stiffness corresponding to bending, then we will be getting U1 V1 W1 dou W by dou X at 1, dou W dou X at 1, so on as a degree. You combine them and assemble them, we will be getting the stiffness matrix for a shell. C1 continuous shell, can you guess the degrees of freedom for a 4 node quadrilateral? For a 4-noded quadrilateral, can you guess the number of degrees of freedom? U and V for in plane, for thin plane, W, dou W by dou X, dou W by dou W, 5. 4 nodes, 20. 20 by 20 is the stiffness. This stiffness matrix is not available straight away. Out of that, 8 by 8 will be formulating for in plane load. 12 by 12 will be formulating for bending load, will be superimposing that. That will be shell. Then we have the shells, little next level. Shell, cylindrical shell, spherical shell, arbitrary shell. So far we have taken the element mid plane is aligned with the xy plane. The element mid plane is aligned with the xy plane. Is it right? If all the elements are not aligned to the same x-y plane, what will it? Take the case of a cylinder. A plate is bent into the form of a cylinder, a big cylinder. What will it? Huh? If we cut them along the circumference, if we cut them, can we take each one to be almost flat? If we divide them into number of divisions along the circumference, at the lower level we can make them into flat. Now we have xy for this element here, xy for this element here. What will it? On the side you take, on the side of the cylinder, these are xy. The plane is like this. On the top it is like this. In between we have incline. How can we tackle it? Is the problem clear? Once you identify the problem, the solutions already we have seen earlier. We have two elements in two different coordinate systems. We need to combine them together. What to do? Transform all of them to a common coordinate system. Transform all of them to a common coordinate system. Then assessment. Normally what happens here? W is always in a perpendicular to xy direction. W is always perpendicular to xy. xy is the plane of the plate. The plane is gradually rotating. Now if I can define what is the angle, that is, we can say, we can define a parameter from this element to this element, then the fist. If we can model this in terms of this angle, then obviously we can transform them to a common coordinate system and we can easily assemble them together and it will go for solution. So that's the caution one has to explain when you come to shell. Now you recall. If you are taking an orbit, even for a cylinder aspect, arbitrary shell, think of the flat plate that is there behind the chain, the supporting back of the chain. What a shape of them? It is a cylinder with a huge radius. Like maybe if I take that as one or two elements, probably that change in angle is very small. Think of the fan blade. There are two changes in. So xy is not very common. As for the case, we have to identify. So there comes representation of the geometry of the shell and representation of the field variables of the shell, and is there any common coordinate direction, or do we need to transform them? All those things make it the problem a little more involving. I don't say it is difficult. Once understand the process of transforming all of them to a common coordinate system, if you know the process, 10 elements or 100 elements or 1000 elements, only time of computation is different. Our task of developing a code is same. What is it? So you try to locate some of the elements available in ANSYS and try to interpret. Okay? So with this we conclude this topic and also on elasticity problems. Any doubt on this so far? That of saving 1 hour here, thinking you are familiar with plates and shells. But your familiarity is not up to the mark. Any doubt on this? Okay then. Next week we are going to have two sessions, right? We take up heat transfer problems. We're coming to classes, heat transfer problems. And if required, one class. We can think of